it's not a silly little moment. It's not the storm before the calm. This is the deep and dying breath. This love that we've been working on. Can't seem to hold you like I want to. So I can feel it. Hello, hello. What's up, everybody, and welcome to the second edition of the Lone Gunman Podcast. This is your boy, Rob Clark, welcoming you back, or for the first time. If it is your first time, I would encourage you to go back and listen to the first one first. It'll let you in on what this podcast is going to be about. And I just want to get something out of the way real quick. I'd just like to thank everybody for taking the time to listen. I'm sure, like most of the people, you know, if you're taking the time to listen to this JFK podcast, then you probably feel pretty much about it like I do. You know, it's more than a hobby. It's not quite an obsession, but maybe it's reached that level a time or two. But, you know, I just like to thank you again. And if you like what you hear, just please share, listen, spread the word. All over social media, whatever you got, Facebook, Tumblr, Instagram, whatever. I just wanted to make sure you know that I'm always going to keep it real here. I don't like the word politically correct. I think it's crap. And I'm always going to keep it real. So, there might be cursing. There might be opinions you don't agree with. And that's fine. Just know, you know, there's nobody backing me. There's nobody sponsoring me. There's nobody giving me money. It's just a passion. And that is it, pure and simple. And what's weighing heavy on my mind today, before we actually get into the meat and bones of this podcast, it just amazes me, because I know most of the listeners here are going to come from Facebook. And in real life, and I don't know about anybody else, but I'm sure most of you can relate to this, that in real life, most of us don't have anybody to talk to about this. Because to most people, they just don't care. They're not interested. It means nothing to them whatsoever. You know, they'd much rather worry about going to Starbucks or, you know, watching Jersey Shore, whatever, you know. And the more and more kids coming up, the less and less interest it's going to be. And, you know, Cyril Wecht had his conference passing the torch. And, you know, the question is, who's going to be grabbing it? You know, a lot of these first generation researchers are dead or retired, quote. You know, sure, you have a couple middlings and you have a couple wannabes, you know, but you still have some good people out there doing still good research. You know, I'd recommend Greg Parker's new book, the Lee Harvey Oswald's Cold War, and the subsequent books I'm sure that he's going to be putting out are going to be great as well. There's always going to be new information to find out. But the point of what I'm saying is that it's a great thing for all of us to be able to connect to each other and talk to each other and share with each other. And it's something that we don't get to do in real life. And when you spend so much time doing this, you know, you make really good friends, you meet some really great people, you also meet some really horrible people, and I would just, this is not directed towards the horrible people, but to the good people out there, even though I've never met you in real life, I know that if I did, that we'd get along good and we'd be friends in real life. But anyway, back to the point.
This week, I'd like to speak to you a little bit about Mr. Buell Wesley Frazier. Now, we all know Buell's tale that he told the Warren Commission. And if you don't know, this might not be the podcast for you. But if you don't, feel free to Google Buell Wesley Frazier and it'll tell you everything he told him. Now, there's a couple things about Buell Wesley Frazier that they don't quite add up. They don't quite make sense. And quite frankly, I think Buell Frazier is lying, is a liar. That's right. Some people don't like to hear that. For some reason, they think Buell Frazier is the sacred cow of the assassination. Sure, he comes across as a real nice, down-to-earth guy. Real soft-spoken. Talk like this about Lee Oswald. Well, I said, sure, Lee. Go, I, no problem, buddy. I'll give you a lift. Okay, now, here's a problem I have with Buell Frazier. All right, and it all starts, okay. Just from reading testimony, you read about working at the TSBD, okay. In the meantime, around the time that Frazier and Oswald are hired, okay, there was eight other black employees that had been laid off. Okay. Now, when you lay people off, it kind of means that, hey, we don't need you right now, but we might in the future. So you can either get another job or you can wait. And they did keep on other black employees. We know that. We got Bonnie Ray, Junior Jarman, Harold Norman, Charles Givens. So it's not like they didn't have any there. So why the need to hire Buell Frazier and Lee Oswald? Now, if it weren't for Buell Frazier and his sister, Lee Oswald would have never known about that job. He never would have got that job at the school book depository. Okay? That's indicator number one. Stay with me here. Okay? Indicator number two. All right, Lee goes, checks it out, goes and talks to Mr. Roy Truly. Truly hires him on the spot. No problem. Bam. Hired. So now we have Buell training Lee to do this job, okay, which basically consisted of going from floor to floor to floor to floor and pulling different books and getting all these orders together and getting ready for shipment. Now, as you know, back then, there was two versions of textbooks, okay? You had the student's version, and you had a teacher's version. Excuse me. Now, the teacher version, you know, had different notes, had the answers to whatever, you know, little quizzes or whatever in the book. You know, and the student's version was the one that they learned from, and the teacher's version is the one they taught from. Okay, and from listening to different testimony of the people there, it was very, very hard to pull an order 100% correct the first time. Because somehow, some way, something would always get screwy. As you can imagine, you know, when you jump from floor to floor, box to box, teacher's edition, student edition, the numbers and everything else. Okay, well, they have Buell Frazier, who'd only been there for 9 weeks, okay, training Lee Oswald when he's hired. So they have a new hire training another new hire to do his job. And somehow Lee Oswald is able to pull these orders flawlessly. No mistakes. Hardly ever. Okay. He didn't much talk to anybody. But he managed to pull these orders flawlessly just about every time. And he was kind of known for it in the little short time he was there. So we have Buell Frazier, you know, training Lee Oswald. You know, they're spending a good amount of time together. The Payne's house is a couple doors down from the Randalls, where Frazier's staying. Of course, Marina's staying with the Paynes, and Oswald goes there sometimes on the weekends, you know, to spend time, you know, with Marina and the kids. And okay, now fast forward a little bit to about 2 weeks before the assassination. We have reports from the Sportsdrome rifle range of two fellas there screwing around, shooting at other people's targets. But that's not the only time. Several people encountered these two, and including another patron, the owner, and an employee. And supposedly the employee actually helped one of them sight in the rifle, commenting that it was one of the clearest small-powered scopes he'd seen. And when you know when you and he actually shot the rifle, he sighted it in and shot the rifle, you know, for either Lee, who he said was Lee, or this other fella. Now he said the other fella was tall, about 6 foot, and the other guy about 5'7", 5'8". Both about 150, 160 pounds, and that the tall fella had dark hair, which Buell did back then. It was very dark. And drove an older model vehicle, which Buell did. I think he drove a 1940 something. I can't remember if it was a Chevy or a Ford right now. Or something like that. They all pretty much looked the same back then in the 40s, unless you're a huge car buff. But, which is, you know, it's not far out of the ordinary, okay? See, back then, you know, there wasn't a lot of things to do, you know, especially in the South. When you're young and, you know, either you can go spend your evenings in the bar getting drunk or chasing women, or, you know, you say, hey, Lee, how'd you like to go shooting after work today? Huh. And, of course, you're a former Marine, and I'm sure somebody who's hunted before. You know, Lee said, sure, that'd be fun. You know, that'd be real fun. We can do that. Okay. Now, so either Lee has to have his own rifle to shoot with, or he's going to have to borrow one from somebody else. Now, I have a problem with that rifle being Lee Oswald, the Manica Carcano. Just from Gil Jesus and John Armstrong's research, I don't think that the paper trail holds up to that, you know, being his rifle. I don't think he ordered it. I think the FBI fraudulently came up with that order slip, and Harry Holmes, the postmaster, was in on it too. That's just my personal belief, but either way, okay, if he had a rifle, he had the rifle. If he didn't, then he had to borrow one from somebody. Okay, don't worry about it, Lee. I got an extra one you can use. It's kind of a piece of crap, but it works just fine. Okay, so they go to the rifle range. They shoot around a little bit. Oswald's messing with the rifle. We'll say Buell's, you know, bent down and picks up a couple spent shells. We better pick these up, throw these away, Lee. Okay. So he pockets a couple of them. All right. Now, the version of events that Buell Frazier has been telling us for 50 years is that he picked up Lee, or Lee showed up at his house that morning. He got in his car. He turns around the back and said, oh, what's in the package, Lee? Curtain rods. Oh, remember I told you? Oh, okay. Yep, curtain rods. All right, go to Dallas, park at the TSBD, the other building, which is a block and a half away, which is where they had to park. And he said that Oswald got out, grabbed his package, cupped it under his armpit, and started walking. But that he had to stay behind to rev his engine up, so his battery wouldn't be dead when he got off work. Okay, problem is, nobody saw Oswald come into that building with a package. Jack Doherty was standing back there, saw Oswald come in the building, no package, okay? So, who's lying? Well, It turns out, if you look up the HSCA testimony of Edward Shields, who was a depository employee at the other building, not the Elm Street one, that when Buell Frazier showed up for work that morning, another co-worker, I think it's Charles Gibbons, hollered out to Buell. He said, "Where's your rider?" Because apparently it was so commonplace for Buell and Oswald to come to work together. Well, that's a new one, because I haven't heard that before. But it does make sense when you think about this. Where's the bus driver that drove the killer of the president to work for 6 weeks? Where's all the people that rode on that bus with the killer of the president for 6 weeks straight? Because when people ride the bus that early in the morning, they're going to work. And they go to work every day. Okay? So they would have noticed this guy. Oh my God, that's the guy that killed the president. We've been riding on the damn bus with this guy for 6 weeks straight. Didn't know it. Well, you haven't heard of him because they don't exist. Okay? Oswald had to get to work somehow. Okay? Why not nice guy Buell? "Lee, it's no problem, buddy. I'll swing by and pick you up on my way in from Irving every day. We'll grab you and I'll take you home too." All right. No problem. Okay, so apparently Buell answered him by saying, "I dropped him off at the building." And Edward Shields is standing right there and he hears all this. Okay? And Edward Shields has no reason to lie about anything. He's just standing there. So let's think about the implications of that for a second. Of Oswald being dropped off at the building by Buell Frazier that morning. Okay? Now, even still, Doherty said he saw Oswald come in, no package. Okay? But you got to think to yourself, why would Buell lie about bringing Oswald to work and taking him home every day? Because that puts him in real close company with Mr. Oswald, the accused assassin of the president. And Buell doesn't want to be in that position. Okay? Now, take this as a for instance. Now, I'm going to take a little journey into what if land, okay? All right, what if, you know, after Gibbons yelled at him, "Hey, where's your rider?" Dropped him off at the building, okay? Da-da-da-da-da, Eddie Shields gets done with his cigarette, flicks it, walks back inside, and Buell's sitting there revving his car up. Looks around, okay, well, nobody's around. He gets out, pops the trunk, grabs a package out of the trunk. Him being a little taller and lankier than Oswald, maybe he could fit a 3-foot package up under his armpit and get into work without anybody seeing it. Possible. Nobody saw Frazier come to work that day, or actually come in the building. And the odd part about it was that this day, Frazier had put all his stuff in the basement. When he got to work. And normally, you know, he ate with the other guys there. He, you know, he ate lunch in the lunchroom or the domino room and, you know, talked to the other fellas. But this day was different. So when he's standing out in front of the Texas School Book Depository watching the motorcade come by, he looks around and he said, there's a couple people out there eating, and he got a little hungry. So he went back down to the basement to get his lunch. So he comes back up. He's eating out there. President comes by. You know, it is what it is. Now, he said he stood out there so long on them front steps that he saw Oswald walk out of the building, walk down Elm Street to Houston to Maine. But in the photographs taken after the assassination, or in films, I just don't see Frazier anywhere up on them steps. Now, I do see him in the Wigman film, and there's a couple stills of that where you can see him plain as day. He's black jacket, black hair, standing right there on them steps. Can't see him in the Alchins because he's probably back up in the shadows, but you can clearly see him in the Wigman. He's out there. Now, when Baker and Truly come in, there's a problem. They can't get an elevator down. apparently the elevators weren't working because Sandra Stiles and company tried to take the elevator down when they were leaving the fourth floor immediately after the assassination took place. So they had to walk down the back stairs. So right there tells you the elevators weren't working for a little while. There was a secretary in there. The phone system went down for a little while. Okay? So what if after Trulian Baker ran into the building, all right, they can't get the elevator to work, they go up the steps. Frazier comes in, goes down to the basement, turns the elevators back on, turns the phones back on. Suddenly they're working. But did he buy enough time for the assassin, the real assassin, to make their getaway? That's the question. Now remember, after the assassination, they couldn't find Buell Frazier either. Okay, he was in a hospital visiting his sick dad when they found him, like 3 hours later. And they kept him for 8 hours, gave him a lie detector test, interrogated him. You know, we still don't know the results of this lie detector test. You know, some people say he passed it, some people say he failed it, but we don't have the official documents. You know, we know that Fritz tried to fight him and tried to get him to sign a confession, well, according to him. Now, why would you do all that when you already have your suspect? They had Lee Oswald in custody by 2 o'clock. Okay? They didn't even find Frazier until like 4 or 5 o'clock. But they had their guy. Okay, so why are they putting heat on Buell Frazier? Well, I'll tell you why. They had to have somebody put a package or a rifle in Oswald's hand and walk and going into that building with it. Now, maybe, and we're going to the land of maybe again. I like it there. Buell said, okay, I'll give you your package, but you know what? I am not copping that some bitch being 36 inches long. No way, no how, because you are not going to, you know, tie me into this shit. He said, I'll give you him taking a package, and it'd be something to argue about, you know. But I'm not going to say it was 36 inches long, because that puts me bringing the rifle, the shooter, and it could possibly be an accessory, dropping him off at the building, all this other stuff. No way. But I'll tell you, he had a package. I'll tell you what, he told me he had curtain rods in a package. It's about 2 feet long. Yeah, we'll go with that. Now, I don't know if he told them that or this is what he's thinking in his head. And he just dropped the whole 24-inch curtain rod story later on him. It's hard to tell because we'll never know. But those are just a couple of my thoughts on Mr. Buell, Wesley Frazier. And also interesting to note, there was a book back in the 70s written called The Assassination Tapes. And it was determined using voice stress analysis that Buell Frazier was lying in his subsequent news interviews, you know, like the next day or whatever. He took a reporter for a ride in his car on the ride from Irving into Dallas. You know, they reenacted the trek to work, and they determined that that Frazier was lying. They determined that Oswald was telling the truth in custody, and the author of the book tracked Frazier down. Now, Frazier's a very hard man to get, to interview, to research, because there is no Buell Frazier book. You know, how many researchers can you name off the top of your head that have gotten to question Buell Frazier? This is the only guy that I can think of, and he had a hell of a time getting to him. I mean, they lied to him about where he was at. You know, he was stonewalled by attorneys, and he finally tracked him down at some military base down there in Texas. Got a hold of him, you know. Buell pretty much told him the story right there in person again, and they determined he was lying again. So, there you have it, people. Something is definitely fishy about Buell Frazier, and I am not afraid to say it. And if you have anything to, you know, the contrary, I'd like to hear it. But they had to get that right. If you don't believe that Oswald was up there shooting on the sixth floor, then you have to believe he was framed. You have to believe he was set up. And by who? Who better than somebody else that works there in this building? Okay? It's real simple. Somebody not conspicuous. Somebody that could have been in there and not drawn any attention to themselves. Who better than the guy who befriended Lee? Who went shooting with Lee? Who gave Lee rides to and from work? And then lie about doing that. The man obviously has something to cover. And what it is, we'll never know. But it'd be nice if we did. Because Buell Frazier is still alive. He's only 70 years old. He's still with us. As is Marina. As is Brother Robert. As is Ruth Payne. You know, why is it only the people that toe the company line are still alive? Ask yourself that one. You already know the answer. Okay? It would just be nice. It's a hope for researchers. It's just a hope that these people come clean, you know, before they pass on. Or leave something. Anything. Don't make us wait until 2035 or 2038 or 2017 to figure all this stuff out. Don't make us wait. Just come clean before you die. You know, in this land of internets and podcasts and everything, Buell Frazier might hear it, might recommend it to him. It might get to him somehow. So, Buell, if you're listening, do a in-depth interview with a researcher. Do an interview with me. I'd love to interview you. I'd love to put you on the spot. Answer the hard questions, my friend. Give us some answers, okay? You've got to know how important you are to this whole thing. And you can maybe help us crack this case wide open a little bit by telling us what you know. But I'm just going to leave it there for that one. And I would like to once again thank everybody for tuning in. And I would also encourage you to please check out my buddy Doug's podcast, also on Spreaker. He's doing it up big on his side. He's got the Dallas Action Podcast. He's two episodes in. It sounds great. He's doing a good job. And he actually ran into a little trouble on Facebook. Everywhere he posted that link to his second podcast about Loranne Hall, disappeared. Poof, gone. So maybe he struck a nerve with somebody somewhere and he's getting a little too close to the truth. And let's hope that's the case. And yeah, like I said, please go search on Spreaker for Doug Campbell or the Dallas Action Podcast and you'll find him. I created a Facebook page for this podcast, the Lone Gunman Podcast. So you can search that on Facebook. It'll have all the new episodes there. Keep you apprised of what's going on. And I guess that's it. You guys have a good one. And we'll see you on episode number 3. All right. Remember, live, laugh, love. And hug your loved ones. And tell them how much you love them. Every day. Every moment of every day if you can. Because you never know when it's going to be your last. And now, a special dedication to a friend of mine who recently lost a loved one. Just know we're out here thinking about you, brother. Stay strong, keep your head up, and Godspeed, God bless, and just know she's in a better place. Rob Clark out.
When I look into your eyes, it's like watching the night sky, all beautiful sunrise, well, there's so much they hold.